Traveling Through the Stars Can Have Its Danger, Part 2. Meanwhile, back on Eurotopia. Rachella enjoyed the training she received in preparation for Starship One's maiden voyage. With her background in technology, she reveled in learning all about the shipboard systems. With her innate abilities to understand complex technical information combined with a superior intellect, she was able to gain a thorough understanding of all the major shipboard systems that included the theories behind them. The officer who had given the SAG presentation walked over to Rachella, seated up front. "I would love to have you as my first officer, ma'am. Your questions and general knowledge of the ship's engineering systems are amazing," said Engineering Chief Commander Suzon. "Why, thank you, Commander Suzon. I am honored. Your SAG systems lecture was fascinating. The system is truly remarkable. Based on all I've heard and seen these last 2 weeks, I can tell these ship systems are in good hands," Rachella replied. Indeed, the technology surrounding the shielding array generator was extraordinary. The SAG consisted of a massive quantity of individual arrays built right behind the ship's outer hull. Each array had a Toltec crystal as its central component that was tuned to a specific frequency. A complex algorithm was employed to link all the radiating crystals. When the different energies and frequencies from the Toltec crystals combined, they created an extremely powerful force field effect that radiated out from the ship's hull and formed an oval-shaped energy shield that surrounded the starship. Eurotopian scientists and engineers developed the SAG system to allow close observation of Eurotopia's sun. Due to the rigors of deep space travel and the unknown conditions that might arise, Fleet Command insisted on the development of an even more powerful SAG systems for its deep space vessels. Captain Pikeson entered Fleet Command's training auditorium. Everyone in the room quieted down and acknowledged his presence. The captain walked up to the lectern and looked out over the group. "I hope everyone has acquired a better understanding of all the various shipboard systems through these excellent lessons and hands-on training from Commander Suzon and his staff. As a member of the crew, it is vital that each crewmate have a thorough understanding of all systems utilized on the spacecraft. Regardless of current duties, each one of you might be asked to assume further responsibilities as conditions dictate. As all of you are aware, Starship One is scheduled for departure in 2 days. I ask that y'all take the next 2 days to get your affairs in order. Please report to Fleet Command Shuttle Transport Station at 0700 hours on Solar Day 1. Thank you all, and we'll see everyone in a couple days." As everyone started to leave the auditorium, Captain Pikeson waved at Rachella and gestured for her to come over. Rachella walked over to the captain and smiled. "Madam Counselor, I hope your training has been informative." "It has indeed, Captain." "Excellent. I again just want to let you know how happy we all are that you accepted our invitation to join us on this maiden voyage. I do not suspect there is much of anything that would stop me from joining you and your crew at this point, Captain. I find the thought of exploring deep space fascinating. I feel very honored to be part of such a grand journey." "Madam Counselor, your role in bringing this new development in Eurotopia's history to fruition has benefited all of Eurotopia and our people. With that said, we have reserved a private cabin for you on the ship." "I truly appreciate the gesture, but I am more than fine sharing a space." "Nonsense. You are a cherished guest. I look forward to seeing you again in 2 days." Captain Pikeson shook Rachella's hand while bowing slightly in respect before turning to address a question from Commander Suzon. After chatting a while with some of her fellow students and upcoming crewmates, Rachella headed to the transport area to board a sky transport to her residence in the city. Let's go to Larian Lake and Magnificent Falls, shouted Rosella to her husband as she walked into the condo. That sounds splendid, love. We can leave first thing in the morning on the high-speed rail and arrive just in time for lunch at the Aleutian Cafe. I will start working on arrangements now, responded Cicero as he hugged his wife and gave her a passionate kiss. The idea just came to me while I was flying over here. What better place to spend our last couple days together for a while? I couldn't agree more. I will book us a suite in the Royalton Hotel. Then we'll be walking distance from the lake and falls. You are so good to me. I have some last-minute details to take care of. Maybe we can watch some virtual theater later, said Rochelle as she headed into the bedroom to change into more comfortable clothes. Walking into her study, Rochelle called out to her AI assistant. Grace, please message all co-counselors my notes and suggestions concerning the Space Commons Initiative, and inform them that I'd like to schedule a time to discuss possible implementation of this action when I return. Also, please bring up all volumes of the sacred text and all my notes and thoughts from current research on it. As Rochelle perused the information on the desk monitors, she began to have a memory flashback of a special time with Rochelle. Today, dear one, I would like to introduce you to some special powers that are possible with practice and dedication, said Rochelle, as she placed a white crystal on the glass table in the backyard of Rochelle's childhood home. Both Rochelle and Rochelle stood about 20 feet from the table. Rochelle closed her eyes briefly before opening them to stare at the crystal. Within seconds, the crystal started to change colors and radiate light in all directions. Soon, the crystal's color changed to a magnificent shade of violet and white light. The vibrations within created an almost angelic choir of sounds. Once the crystal returned to its natural form, Rochelle looked at Rochelle with amazement. That was beautiful. Can I try? Of course. Just center yourself and then push energy from your core like I have shown you before. While you channel the energy to the crystal, ask the crystal to sing to you. Rochelle closed her eyes and emptied her mind of all thoughts. Once her mind was at peace, Rochelle opened her eyes and stared at the white crystal. Soon the crystal started to change colors. After stabilizing on a beautiful shade of blue and white light, it started to create a very enjoyable sound. Clearly impressed with Rochelle's relative ease in making the crystal sing, Rochelle looked at her young apprentice and nodded before saying, Rochelle, I think you are ready to expand on your powers. Tomorrow morning, let us take a rail to the wind power turbines south of the city. I have an interesting experiment in mind. That sounds wonderful, Maymay. I can hardly wait to go, exclaimed Rochelle. Riding towards the wind turbines, Rochelle felt very content. While most 15-year-old girls preferred spending time with their peers rather than with their parents or other adults, she realized how much she enjoyed her time with Rochelle. She cherished the loving bond that had formed between them. Just then, Rochelle gave Rochelle a big smile as she lovingly touched her arm. Within a short time, they arrived at the wind farm. Disembarking from the train, Rochelle took in the fresh morning air as she admired the huge wind turbines in the distance. Standing over 100 feet in the air, these windmills had four 30-foot blades connected to the main shaft coming out horizontally towards the top portion of the turbine's vertical platform. Walking hand in hand, Rochelle and Rochelle made their way towards one of the wind turbines. With the windmill still 50 yards away in the distance, Rochelle stopped their walk towards the turbine. Dear one, as you well know, the power of these spinning blades is quite strong. I would like you to use your natural energy inside to stop the turning blades and make them change direction. One hint for success would be to ask the wind for help as you visualize the blades stopping and turning backwards. Excited to see if she could do it, Rochella quickly centered her mind and began to visualize the huge blades stopping their movement. Within minutes, the massive turbine's blades started to slow down, while all the other wind turbines in the area continued spinning powerfully in a clockwise direction. This lone turbine was now completely stopped. With her mind still centered in that peace, Rochella began to visualize the huge blades turning in a counterclockwise motion. Along with her visualization, she also began to calmly ask the wind for help in moving the blades. Within minutes, this giant wind turbine was rotating counterclockwise, while all the others still spun in a clockwise direction. Wrapping her arm around Rochella's shoulders, Rochelle said, "Excellent, you are a natural at harnessing your powers. Let's head back to the city and get one of your favorite Portarian dishes to share." "I would love that, Maymay," said Rochelle as she looked up at her mentor and smiled deeply. With her thoughts returning to the present, Rochelle thought to herself, "It's going to be so wonderful to spend time with Maymay when I get back from the voyage." Riding north out of the city and through the rolling countryside, flush with various crops grown for Creation and the surrounding areas, Rochelle marveled at the lush vegetation and trees that displayed themselves in all their beauty from the electric train's cabin window. Nestled against Cicero's chest while sitting in the plush seats of the train, Rochelle felt comfortable and extremely loved. Their destination this day was a special place for both Rochelle and Cicero. The small village of Divinia was a home to Alarian Lake and the grand Magnificine Falls that kept the lake full year-round. This popular haven in the northern Appalachian Mountains was where Rochelle and Cicero had spent their honeymoon. After a couple hours, the Appalachian mountain range started to come into view out of their cabin window. Some of these spectacular mountains rose from close to sea level to almost 20,000 feet in height. Looking at their wondrous creations, Rochelle was once again in awe at their beauty and sheer magnificence as the snow-covered peaks glistened in the sunlight. While most Eurotopians were not religious in a normal sense, each person did feel a deep sense of connection with each other and all life on the planet. For most Eurotopians, all things in existence came from the same source. So the normal separation felt by those in most other races was not how Eurotopians viewed reality. A majority of Eurotopians felt connected to even the smallest creatures or elements that they shared their world with. All Eurotopians were taught these truths from an early age, and they were foundational principles that most Eurotopians embraced and upheld. While Eurotopian society was not perfect, the tenets of this all-in-one philosophy created an almost utopian world for the planet's residents. Watching the breathtaking scenic view of one glorious mountain peak after another go by the window for almost an hour, both Rochelle and Cicero became anxious at the prospect of reaching Divinia shortly. Soon the train's conductor announced the impending arrival at Divinia Station and asked all passengers to prepare for deboarding. Walking off the train to the wonderful smells and sounds of Divinia, Rochelle took in the surroundings with awe once more. In all directions, lush, colorful flowers and other vegetation were in full bloom. The chill Lucian trees were covered in their annual pink and white blossoms. The effervescence gave the surrounding air in Divinia a special fragrant quality. Walking hand in hand on the magnificent stone walkway towards Lucian Cafe, the love between Rochelle and Cicero was quite evident. Laughing over a previous memory of one of their many visits to Divinia, Rochelle and Cicero walked into the Lucian Cafe to the extraordinary smells emanating from the kitchen. "Oh, I so love the smell of the food here," exclaimed Rochelle. It is definitely making me hungry, agreed Cicero. Hearing their arrival, the head chef and manager of the restaurant came out to greet the couple. It is so wonderful to see you again, Madam Counselor and Monsieur Cicero. It is a pleasure to see you again as well, Chef Dion. We are so looking forward to trying some of your wonderful and delicious creations, said Rochella. She gave the chef a big hug. I have just created a couple new dishes I think you both will love, said Chef Dion. He reached out to shake Cicero's hand. These smells are driving me crazy. How about you make enough for everyone and you and your staff come out and join us when it's ready, Cicero suggested, as he anticipated the incredible meal they would soon share. That sounds splendid. I'll have some Candician wine brought out while you wait, said Chef Dion, before he headed back into the kitchen area. Lunch with Chef Dion and his staff was an enjoyable experience of sharing stories and great food among friends. Bidding everyone goodbye, Rochella and Cicero headed out to the Rotarian Hotel to freshen up before going to the Magnificent Falls later that evening. A slight warm breeze came from the balmy turquoise waters of Alarian Lake. Even though cold mountain water came pouring down into the lake from Magnificent Falls, a subterranean flow of heated water bubbled up into the lake from fissures at the bottom of the rock crust. Due to this unique geological feature, Alarian Lake and the surrounding hot springs in the area provided a relaxing adventure for many Eurotopians through even the colder seasons. As they walked into the front lobby of the Rotarian Hotel, the hotelier came over to the couple to greet them. So good to see you both again. As with everyone who comes to Divinia, your luggage was brought over from the train and delivered to your suite. Thank you, Mary Shan. You look lovely as always. It is so good to see you again as well. Perhaps we can all get together for drinks later, Rochella said as she shook the hotelier's hand. My wife is correct. You do look as lovely as ever, agreed Cicero as he kissed the hotelier on her cheek. Their favorite suite had been prepared as Cicero requested when he booked the room. The fireplace was aglow from the burning logs. Thespian incense was smoldering at various locations in the suite. Oh, this brings back so many wonderful memories, exclaimed Rochella as she took in the relaxing ambience. I'm glad you like it, said Cicero as he pulled Rochella in close. Within a short time, initial passionate kisses between the two partners turned into full sexual escapade for the two lovers as they quickly removed their clothing and began to experience oneness once again as their naked bodies and limbs wrapped around themselves in ecstasy. You are an incredible lover, whispered Rochella as she gazed lovingly into Cicero's eyes. You make it so easy, replied Cicero as he ran his hand down Rochella's back and bottom. Let's take a shower and get ready for our adventure at Magnificent Falls. I can hardly wait to see what colors will be seen tonight, Rochella said as she rose from the bed and headed for the bathroom. I am right behind you, love. You know I'm the best back scrubber on the planet. The night air was still warm as they walked the short distance to Magnificent Falls. Upon arriving at the falls, both Rochella and Cicero were in amazement at the grand spectacle before them. Due to some creative bioengineering, various luminous colored algae had been bred to cover the smooth, glistening Grantician rock in unique patterns that spanned the falls from the very top all the way to the bottom, just before it emptied into Alarian Lake. The colorful glowing nature of the special algae created a spectacular and mesmerizing effect for all gazed upon it. I so wish Rochelle could be here to see this. I miss her and can't wait to see her soon, Rochella said as she gazed at the immense beauty before her. Just after she spoke, a brilliant radiating globe of shimmering violet and white light began to shine 20 feet away to the right of where they were standing on the walkway. You told me she was very special, but I suspect Rochelle may be more than I imagine, said Cicero as he too watched the shining globe. After a short while, the radiant spear disappeared. Rochelle and Cicero headed back to the hotel for drinks and hors d'oeuvres with the hotel staff. Next morning, waking up to the sunlight streaming in from the balcony window, the two lovers once again shared themselves with each other and the all that is as their bodies intertwined together on the huge bed. After some wonderful hiking on the beautiful trails that ran around the lake and into the foothills beside it, the couple headed back to the high-speed rail to return to Croatia. I am so going to miss you, said Rochelle as she hugged Cicero. As will I, said Cicero, before giving his beautiful wife a long kiss goodbye. Rochelle headed up to the skyport on the roof of their building to catch an early morning flight to Fleet Command. While riding the sky transport over the beautiful city below, her thoughts of last night's romantic rapture with Cicero flashed back to her. The smell of her lover as he kissed down her body towards her private area still lingered in her memory. The true love she saw in her husband's eyes as he stared at her while she was pushing up against her as she thrust down onto his manhood with legs pushed tightly at his sides made Rochelle shudder all over again. Almost at the brink of orgasm from their intense lovemaking, Rochelle remembered one of her final lessons from Rochelle. Dear one, you are getting to an age where you will begin to truly explore your sexuality. Please always remember that lovemaking is a sacred act performed between two divine beings. The manifestation power generated from consensual sex is an extremely dynamic force that can be used to create almost any desire. To take advantage of this creative power, one should convey their intention to the all that is right at the time of total release. Still on the verge of orgasm, Rochelle sent a powerful thought out to the all that is. Let this maiden journey be a successful one for Starship One and all her crew. Please continue to guide my thoughts as Eurotopia's fantastic journey progresses into the future. With those last intentions conveyed, Rochelle and Cicero began to orgasm together. A smile came to Rochelle as she remembered that final release and how special that moment felt. Within minutes, the transport landed at Fleet Command. Rochelle was escorted to Starship One's shuttle transport for boarding. Soon, Rochelle and other members of Starship One's crew were lifted off the tarmac and flown through the atmosphere into orbit above Eurotopia. The small craft quickly came upon Starship One parked inside the space dock and proceeded to maneuver towards the massive ship's shuttle bay area. After the shuttle docked and all passengers deboarded the craft, Rochelle was greeted by one of the current onboard crew members and escorted to her private cabin. We will be departing space dock soon, Madam Counselor. Please remain in your quarters until the captain indicates otherwise. Is there anything I can get for you? Asked Ancient Rishan before gesturing for Rochelle to enter the cabin. Thank you, Ensign. I know you must have plenty to do right now, and I will be fine, said Rochelle as she entered her new quarters. As with most personal quarters on the ship, the space was small but efficiently furnished for maximum comfort and usability. She stored her personal belongings away and changed into the one-piece outfit that had been provided for her. Along with the normal living items such as a small bed, closet with storage space, and a small bathroom space, each cabin was also equipped with a desk and console linked to all relevant shipboard systems. Sitting down at the desk, Rochelle asked the shipboard artificial intelligence to display the 360-degree view from outside the starship as it began to slowly maneuver out of the docking station in orbit above Eurotopia. Once the ship had completely moved out of the space dock, the starboard side view revealed an amazing vantage point of Eurotopia from the approximately 70 miles above its surface. Lush blue, green, and brown colors shone brightly as the sun hit Eurotopia's surface. As with most life-giving planets, over 70% of Eurotopia's surface was covered in ocean. Due to constant efforts to keep Eurotopia's atmosphere and oceans clean, this view from over 70 miles above was breathtaking to experience. Amazing shades of blue ocean waters were met with the lush green and brown hues associated with each landmass. Rochella's skin tingled as she watched the magnificent sight of Eurotopia slowly move away on the display. Soon, the giant craft gained speed as the impulse drives engaged and propelled the ship towards some of the solar system's outer planets. Within minutes, Starship 1 was approaching one of Eurotopia's fellow planets called Glorishane. While Glorishane could not naturally support life like Eurotopia, it was still an enchanting sight to observe. Four huge, multicolored gaseous and rock-littered rings circled Glorishane, with each succeeding ring circling the previous ring at approximately a 90-degree angle. The result of this natural phenomenon gave Glorishane a gyroscopic effect when viewed from a distance. This is truly extraordinary to watch. I'm so blessed to be part of this, thought Rochella as she continued to observe the incredible views shown on her display. Just as Glorishane started to go out of view, Captain Pikeson came over the shipboard speakers and announced that Starship 1 would be heading back towards the sun to perform some tests of the recent upgrades to the ship's shielding array generator. As the ship flew towards the sun, Rochella was notified by the AI in her cabin that someone was at her door. "Please open the door," Rochella called out to the AI. "I hope I'm not disturbing you, Madam Counselor. The captain has requested your presence on the bridge," said Ancient Rishin as she stood just outside the cabin. "You are not disturbing me at all. I would be delighted to go to the bridge," answered Rochella as she quickly walked out of her cabin to join Ancient Rishin. As the door opened in onto the bridge, Rochella was enthralled at the sight before her. Unlike what she had experienced during her training and recent inspection tour, the bridge was in full operation with much activity from the crew members present. The huge display screen at the front of the bridge showed the sun as it became larger and larger in view. "Madam Counselor, so good of you to come. I thought you might like to observe the tests from here on the bridge," said Captain Pikeson. "Thank you so much for inviting me here, Captain. I would truly enjoy watching the SAG test," Rochella replied enthusiastically. "We are 14,000 kilometers from the sun, sir. Hull temperature is 1,000 degrees Celsius," announced Lieutenant Leishan from his navigation post. "Very well, Lieutenant. Let's come to full stop. Engineering, please ready the shielding array generator," commanded the captain. "Aye, Captain. We are ready when you are," replied Commander Sushan. "Let's set shield strength at 50%, engage the SAG," instructed Captain Pikeson to his engineering chief. Soon, a slightly detectable green haze could be seen wrapping itself around the ship's hull. Rochella watched the force field fully enclose itself around the ship in an oblong shape as it turned a greenish-blue color. "Captain, hull temperature is at 400 degrees Celsius and dropping." "Excellent, Lieutenant. Let's navigate the ship closer. Please let me know when the hull temperature starts to rise." "Ship is 1,000 kilometers out. Hull temperature is 500 degrees Celsius." Thank you, Lieutenant. Let's increase shield strength to 70%. Hold temperature at 300 degrees Celsius and dropping. Satisfied with the SAG testing results so far, Captain Pikeson asked navigation to increase shield strength to 100% and navigate the ship to within 500 kilometers. Hold temperature is at 100 degrees Celsius. Sensors indicate an imminent solar flare at class 5 level in approximately 2 minutes, sir. Let's maintain position, Lieutenant. I am confident the shield will hold. After hearing about the solar flare, Rochella tensed up slightly. She looked towards the captain seated a short distance away from where she sat. Captain Pikenson's confidence gave her reassurance that everything would be okay. 1 minute before solar eruption, announced the helmsman. Brace for impact, everyone, called out the captain from his chair on the bridge. The bridge crew grew silent as everyone waited for the massive solar flare that would slam into the ship's shield in less than a minute. Suddenly, the huge display showed an enormous eruption coming off the sun's surface and heading straight towards the ship. Within seconds, a Class 5 solar flare blasted against the force field surrounding the ship. The massive energy surge from the sun pounding into the shield caused the entire ship to jolt sideways as everyone on the bridge held on to keep from falling over. Ship's hull temperature at 200 degrees, Captain. Excellent. Let's drop shields and navigate back to 24,000 kilometers. Once at 25,000 kilometers, send out one of our probes to get a temperature reading. Aye, sir. Everyone on the bridge began to clap at the successful results of the SAG's first test since its recent upgrade. After a short while, Lieutenant Leshan announced the probe temperature results. Temperature reading was 500 million degrees Celsius before the probe burn up at 400 kilometers, Captain. Thank you all for a successful test. Engineering, please perform a diagnostic on the shielding array generator and let me know the results when it's completed, spoke the captain as he rose from his chair. So, Madam Counselor, what did you think? Spoke Captain Pikeson as he walked towards Rochella. It was a little intense for me, Captain, but it was also amazing to observe, replied Rochella. I will be taking dinner in about an hour. Perhaps you could join me, asked the captain. I would be honored. Excellent. I will see you in the cafeteria around 1800. The captain smiled and nodded at Rochella before heading over to the science station to review some recent data from the probe. Walking into the crew's mess area, Rochella spied the captain sitting with Commander Suzon at the table towards the rear of the room. Upon seeing Rochella approach the table, both men stood up to greet her. Glad you could make it, Madam Counselor, said the captain as he shook Rochella's hand. So good to see my star student again, spoke Commander Suzon as he too reached out to shake Rochella's hand. Thank you, gentlemen. I hope I'm not interrupting anything. No, not at all, Madam Counselor. The commander was just updating me on the SAG diagnostic results. Captain Pikenson pulled out a seat for Rochella. I hope the results were good, said Rochella, before nodding thanks to the captain and taking her seat. They were indeed, ma'am. All tests came out at 100%, said Commander Suzon as he sat back down. I am so thrilled to hear that, Commander. And you both can call me Rochella if you'd like. Perhaps in these informal settings, Madam Counselor, that would be okay. But we all have a huge amount of respect for you and what you have done for Fleet Command and Eurotopia, said Captain Pikeson as he smiled at Rochella. Well, thank you, Captain. It has been a true honor to serve the Utopian people in any capacity that I can. Rising from the table, Commander Suzon nodded to Captain Pikeson and Rochella and said, Well, I need to return to engineering. It was a pleasure to see you again, Madam Counselor. Please come by engineering when you get the chance. It was wonderful to see you again as well, Commander. I will definitely plan on stopping by engineering soon. Once the commander had left, Captain Pikeson asked, I hope you like what I ordered. It is shipboard food, but the chefs can still whip up some pretty tasty meals. Thank you, Captain. I am sure it'll be wonderful, replied Rochella. I am so glad the SAG performed as expected. As am I. Unfortunately, not every race in this galaxy is as charming as the Eurotopians. Having a good defensive system will help ensure our safety as we begin to explore our galaxy. I have seen reports concerning the aggression from what has been described as a warlike race. I am also glad we have upgraded the shielding array generator system and added the weapon systems recommended by the Andosians, Rochella said just before one of the crew came over with their food. Excuse me, Captain and Madam Counselor, here is the food you ordered. Thank you, Airman, the captain said as the crew members set the food down. So what are the plans now, Captain? Asked Rochella before taking a bite of her food. We will make some short runs around our solar system through the night to check on various mining operations, and tomorrow morning we will plot a course to Sector 4 and prepare to take the ship into FDL. That sounds wonderful, Captain. Seeing a whole new part of our galaxy will be so exciting. After getting to know each other a little better, the Captain and Rochella talked more about the mission and their thoughts on Eurotopia's future. Just as they were both getting ready to leave, the Andosian, who was second in command to Captain Pikeson, came over to the table with a somewhat stern look. After the first officer had finished whispering in the captain's ear, the captain excused himself and left with the commander. The captain appeared somewhat disturbed when he excused himself. I do hope everything is all right, thought Rochella as she walked back to her quarters. Within the hour, the captain's voice came over the shipboard speakers. I have just finished consulting with Fleet Command concerning an incident that was conveyed to us by our Andosian partners in Sector 7. Our current mission has changed. We will be navigating to Sector 7 within the hour. All crew members, please report to your duty stations. Soon, the cabin AI told Rochella someone was at the door. Opening the door, Rochella was greeted by Ensign Rayshon. The captain has asked me to inform you that he would like you to stay in your quarters for the time being. If there is anything you need, please ask the AI to contact me. Thank you, Ensign. I will, spoke a shaken Rochella. After the door closed, she walked over her desk to find out as much as she could about this warlike race the Andosians had warned Fleet Command about. Unable to explain why, her intuition was telling her that they were going to be somehow involved in this incident that the captain had just conveyed to the crew. 100 miles above the planet Terran in the Ellipshan vessel Drago Crichton. The delegation to Terran was unsuccessful in securing an agreement with the inhabitants of the planet. Scans indicate advanced weapons capability, but nothing our shields and weapons could not defend and counter, spoke second in command, Lorsham, to the captain as he came on the bridge. I do not understand why they would reject our generous offer. Did you explain to them that aligning with us would be in their best interest? Exclaimed Captain Crichton to his first officer. I did, sir. It almost seemed like they were apprehensive about partnering with us. Even implied threats did not seem to deter their intent to not collaborate with us, replied Captain Loris John. Well, regardless, this Hellishan substance is too important for Ellipshan and our space fleet. After a short pause, the captain toggled his personal intercom. Engineering, begin preparing our weapon systems. I believe a demonstration is in order, barked the captain as he strode back and forth on the bridge. As with many of the advanced races in the galaxy, the Terrans had already heard about this new aggressive race that had begun to cause turmoil throughout the galaxy. While getting plans for some of the Elipsion technologies would benefit the Terrans in their own space program, they also knew that aligning with this reptilian humanoid race would not endear the Terrans to many of the other advanced races in the galaxy. Intuitively, the Terrans also felt that any collaboration with this race would be short-lived at best. This became even more apparent after Terran representatives met with the Elipsion delegation sent down from the giant spacecraft orbiting their planet. While Terrans were an intellectual-based race who prided themselves on their ability to use reason to solve problems and to develop the technologies that allowed their society to flourish, the Elipsion delegation they encountered seemed barbaric in both appearance and mannerisms. Standing almost 7 feet tall, the large and muscular Elipsion delegation members, who all wore body armor and various weapons strapped to their belts, were indeed an imposing presence, and their leader was even larger than the rest of the delegation. As the Elipsion leader spoke, his huge razor-sharp teeth could not be missed. Seeing the talks were not going as planned, the leader of the delegation of large humanoid reptilians spoke to the other members in a language that resembled hissing sounds of various tones. Speaking one last time to the Terran representatives to try and secure agreement, the leader's tone and implied threats did not go over well with the Terrans at all. I believe this discussion is not in the best interests of the Terran people and should come to an end. Please convey our regret in not being able to secure an agreement between our peoples, spoke the female leader of the Terran representatives. With that, the reptilian leader spoke quickly to the others. They all looked at the Terran delegation with disdain before turning and leaving the meeting place to head back to their transport vessel. As soon as the Elipsion craft lifted off the ground, the Terrans sent out a distress call to the Andosians, who had recently visited their planet to inquire about a possible alliance. Back on the ship, Captain Kreischoldshan prepared his next move. Find me a formidable target with the least amount of Terran casualties, commanded the captain to his bridge crew. The science officer spoke timidly to the captain. The largest mountain on the third quadrant looks to be the least inhabited, sir. Very well. Let's prepare the missile launch on the next orbit over Quadrant 3, commanded the captain to his helmsman. Aye, sir. PML weapon is ready for deployment in 1 minute, replied the helmsman. With the mountain now in sight, the helmsman said, missile lock is engaged and ready at your command. Fire the weapon at the target, commanded the captain. As before, the Tyran-based matter-based missile precisely struck the mountain. After a blinding light and incredibly loud explosion, the spot where the huge mountain once was located was now an enormous hole in the ground. Upon hearing the news of the mountain's destruction and resulting casualties, the Terran leadership sent out a second distress call in the hopes that some spacefaring race would intercept it. Aboard Starship One, en route to planet Terran. As Starship One continued to navigate at FTL speed towards the threat in Sector 7, Rochelle reviewed all the reports surrounding the warlike race, creating chaos at various sectors of the galaxy. How could such a primitive acting race even achieve spaceflight capabilities? Wondered Rochelle as she read the reports. Based on Eurotopia's history and what she had learned about the Andosian race, Rochelle just assumed that a majority of spacefaring races in the galaxy would be more benign like her own. While their theory might have been mostly correct, there were races out there that could pose a threat to her world now and in the future. I will need to discuss this with the Council when I return, she thought as she prepared to meditate on the upcoming threat. Relaxing her mind and body while sitting upright in the reading chair in her cabin, Rochelle closed her eyes and began to quiet her mind of all thought as she allowed her mind to enter the void. From this divine place in her mind, she began to ponder the current situation with the special detachment she had been taught by Rachel. I so wish she was here right now. Within a short time, Rachel heard Rachel speak to her in her mind. Dear one, as I am always connected to you, you are about to be part of something that is not entirely set right now. There is a chaotic aspect to your future that has not been fully formed in the universal substance. This unexpected event is just now unfolding. It is vital that you fully embrace all that you have learned and try to retain a detachment from this situation as much as possible. The universal mind is always available for all who seek its unfathomable wisdom. Always remember that you are with all that is, and the sum of all knowledge and wisdom is forever available to you. I must leave you now so you can create your desired future. Remember that all you have been taught and use it wisely. With those words echoing in her mind, Rachel came out of her meditative state. As she became fully conscious, a thought came to her. What is the best way to shut down aggressive behavior? Immediately, Rachel asked her AI to contact Ancient Rishan. Soon, the voice of Ancient Rishan came over her cabin speakers. How can I help you, Madam Counselor? I need to speak with the captain as soon as possible, exclaimed Rachella. After about a minute, Ensign Rayshan's voice came over the cabin speakers. The captain can only spare a brief time, but can meet you in the situation room in 5 minutes. I will come by to get you and take you to the captain. Thank you, Ensign Rishan. Sitting across the table from Captain Pikeson, Rachella told him how her intuition had given her insight that this current threat was most likely due to this warlike race that had been creating havoc throughout the galaxy. Staring at Rachella, Captain Pikeson pondered her words before responding. I'm not exactly sure how your intuition is giving you accurate information concerning our current situation. I'm also not sure how you'll be able to assist us with this matter. Let's just say I have some special skills, Captain, Rachella replied before going into full detail of her plan. Aboard the Elipshan vessel, Drago Kryton, we have located the easiest route to obtain a source of heliocene gas, Captain. The captain acknowledged the helmsman's words before toggling his personal communicator. Engineering, are all the containment modules ready? Aye, Captain. The modules are prepped and ready to take down to the surface, replied Commander Weishan. Turning to his first officer, the captain commanded, Commander, prep a landing party to help with a helicin-based substance extraction and infusion into the containers. In the meantime, we will prepare the area for your arrival. Aye, Captain. I will inform you when we are ready to launch to the surface. With that, Captain Kreidelshan commanded his engineering officer to prepare the ion laser cannon. Once in position, the captain ordered a 50-mile square pattern be blazed with the ILC around the area the helicin had been located. The Terran Council watched the satellite video showing the power and precise nature of the laser cannon's blinding destruction. Lead member Krenos of the Terran Council exclaimed, I fear we cannot defeat these aggressors without assistance. Their weapons technology is unmatched in this sector. If we try to interfere, I'm afraid they may target one or more of our cities. I hope our message has been received. Back on the ship, Commander Lorishan informed the captain they were ready to depart for the surface. Excellent, Commander. We will monitor your progress from here. After this last ILC demonstration, I do not believe the Terrans will make any attempt to interfere with your mission. If they do, I will make sure they regret that decision. Aye, sir. Then we will be on our way. Once on the surface of the extraction site, Commander Loris Shan and his team began the process of removing halogen substance from below the surface so it could be infused into the containment modules for transport and storage on the ship. Inside the Terran solar system. As soon as Starship 1 came out of FTL, Captain Pikeson ordered the helm to immediately navigate behind one of the moons of a giant gas planet at the outer edge of the solar system. With a spacecraft sufficiently camouflaged behind the moon, Captain Pikeson notified engineering to ready the FTL drive for a quick burst to the Terran planet. "Madam Counselor, are you ready to implement your idea?" came the captain's voice over Rochella's cabin speakers. "I am, Captain." As she sat in the cabin chair, Rochella closed her eyes and sought the void of all possibilities. Still somewhat skeptical concerning Rochella's plan, Captain Pikeson did feel that her plan might just give them the time needed to disable the huge battlecraft above Terran. Rochella's small demonstration in the situation room had given the captain a little more confidence in the plan's success. Sitting across the table the previous night, Rochella smiled and told the captain, "Reality is only an elaborate illusion, and it is possible to even create an illusion within the illusion." With that, 10 small replicas of Starship 1 appeared in front of Captain Pikeson's face. Somewhat startled by this illusion that looked so real, Captain Pikeson asked incredulously, "Can you make them larger?" "I believe that shot should not be a problem, Captain." After receiving confirmation from Rochella that she was ready, Captain Pikeson commanded the helmsman to set course for orbit above Terran that would put Starship 1 in proximity to the alien vessel. Once the course was set and engineering confirmed they were ready, Captain Pikeson gave the command to engage. "Captain, we detected a presence of something in the outer edge of this solar system for just a few seconds before it disappeared," exclaimed the Drago Crichton helmsman. "Perform a deep scan of that area, engage shields, and prepare the ILC," shouted Captain Crichton. After a few minutes, the helmsman exclaimed, "Captain, our close-range sensors are now reporting multiple vessels surrounding our ship." "Engage outside view. Shields at full power," shouted the captain. All displays on the bridge were now showing multiple spacecraft on all sides of the Drago Crichton. "How can this be? I need answers now. Perform deep scans on all these vessels and report anything found." Captain Crichton strode around the bridge trying to understand how these vessels showed up so quickly without prior detection. From engineering, Tyshawn watched the monitors and thought to himself, "Why have those enemy vessels not fired upon us yet? We are clearly outnumbered. I am not sure we even have enough halogen to fight off that many ships." Everything that had occurred since he arrived at this planet had seemed disturbing to Tyshawn. When initial negotiations had failed on the surface and the captain ordered the use of the ILC, Tyshawn was shocked at the cruelty of the captain's intent on this world below them. "It does not feel right that we should be forcing the inhabitants of this planet to submit to our demands. We should have looked for a source of halogen that did not involve the possible killing of millions of beings," thought Tyshawn as he continued to stare at the monitor. Back on the bridge, the helmsman called out to the captain, "Sir, deep scan of the vessels indicates similar signatures for 9 of the 10 vessels. The 10th is showing a slightly different impression than the others." After pondering this new information, Captain Crichton quickly gave the command, "Fire the LAC at the vessel showing the difference." As soon as Starship 1 had come out of FTL and stopped near the alien vessel, Rochella heard the captain's voice shout over the cabin speaker, "Now, Madam Counselor." Already in a deep meditative trance, Rochella used her mind to create images of multiple Starship 1 vessels surrounding the alien craft she visualized in her mind. As he watched the outside view of the alien craft and the nine images of Starship One surrounding the alien vessel, Captain Pikeson looked at the screen before him with disbelief. "Captain, they are performing scans on our ship and the surrounding area. Ready the SAG and prepare to fire on the alien vessel on my command," said Captain Pikeson as he continued to watch the amazing sight on the bridge's main display. "Hopefully, this bully will back down and leave the area," thought the captain. "Captain, their scan is locked on us." Just as Captain Pikeson gave the command to raise shields, a blistering blue and white light shot out from the alien vessel and hit Starship One on the starboard side before the shield had fully enveloped the ship. The blast from the alien ship's weapon violently hit the hull with a massive strike that slammed the ship sideways. Flung from her chair, Rochella lost the mental image she had been holding on in her mind. Racing out of the cabin, she headed straight to the bridge. On the bridge's display, the outside view now showed just the alien vessel. "Engineering, I need a damage report right now," shouted Captain Pikeson through the bridge intercom as he got back on his feet. "Captain, an intense laser strike has damaged multiple arrays on the starboard side. The shielding array generator is currently only able to provide 50% force field around the ship. I'm not sure we can create the Tolotec crystals needed in time. That weapon is powerful. We will not be able to withstand any more strikes," thought Captain Pikeson as he pondered his next move. Soon, Rochella came through the bridge door. "Captain, what has happened?" "We were struck with a powerful laser. Multiple arrays are damaged. We need to replace the main Tolotec crystals as soon as possible." "Maybe I can help," shouted Rochella as she ran out of the bridge and towards her cabin. "Direct hit on the ship's starboard side, Captain," called out the helmsman aboard the Drago Crichton. "Excellent, Captain," Crichton Sean toggled his communicator. "Engineering, prepare the ILC for another blast at the alien vessel." "Aye, Captain. We have emptied the first canister of halogen fuel. It'll take about 5 minutes to connect the second canister," replied the engineering chief. "You fool, this confrontation will be over in 5 minutes." The captain looked towards the helmsman. "Prepare to fire the Turon missile on my command." "Missile lock on the alien vessel, sir." "Fire the missile now." After pondering the current situation, Tyshawn thought to himself, "That ship could have easily fired upon us when it first appeared, but they did not. I think they were giving us time to leave the area. I cannot allow us to destroy this alien vessel. This has all been so wrong, and I must make it right, regardless of the consequences." With all the commotion in engineering as the crew rushed to replace the spent canister, Tyshawn quickly raced over to the main control panel for the ILC system. As the rest of the engineering crew worked to install the second canister of halogen fuel, Tyshawn opened the main panel door and quickly unseated one of the critical circuit boards needed to prepare the halogen fuel interface with the laser. Before anyone had noticed, he quickly closed the panel door and returned to assist with the canister changeout. Now back in her cabin, Rochella was knocked out of the chair and to the floor due to yet another hit from the alien vessel. The missile fired from the alien ship struck the force field and exploded on impact. While the SAG held back the blast from damaging the ship any further, the shock of the impact violently shook Starship One once more. Back on the bridge, the helmsman called out to Captain Pikeson, "Shield strength currently at 30%, sir." "Very well. Prepare to fire our laser weapon on my command." Captain Pikeson toggled the communicator on his chair. "Engineering, how are we coming on the new Tolotec crystals?" "We are about 10 minutes out from completing the crystal builds with the RMO system and installation behind the hull," answered Commander Suzon. "I'm not sure why they have not fired upon us again with that laser. I do not want to destroy that vessel, but if we cannot get our shields back up to full capacity soon, I will have no choice but to use our weapons, thought the captain as he continued to observe the enemy ship on the screen. Seated once again in the cabin chair, Rochella began to quiet her mind and detach herself from the current situation. Remember, dear one, it is vital that you detach yourself completely so you can generate all the powers without interference from any stray thoughts that could dilute your focus, rang through Rochella's mind as she continued to move her mind into the void. Once in the void, Rochella opened her mind to the all that is and the infinite information it possessed. She focused her thoughts on the Toltec crystals. With both her previous studies of the crystals and the information she was obtaining from her connection to Infinite Mind, she began to imagine the crystals forming from the universal substance and replacing the damaged ones behind the starboard side hull. Just before Rochella had completed her visualization, a second missile strike from the alien vessel struck Starship 1. The powerful blast once again threw Rochella from her chair and made her jolt from her meditation. Captain, that last missile strike weakened the shields to just 10%. We will not be able to withstand any more hits, exclaimed Lieutenant Lishan. Engineering, it is now or never, shouted the captain. Aye, Captain. We are replacing the crystals as fast as possible, but they are even more damaged than originally anticipated, replied Commander Suzon. Back on the Drago Crichton, Commander Weishan initialized the ion laser cannon, but it showed an error with the interface between the laser and the Halishan fuel canister. Soon, the captain's voice came over the speakers in engineering. Where is my ILC, Commander? We are experiencing a problem with the interface, sir. I will let you know when we are ready, replied the engineering chief. It had better be soon, Commander, came Captain Krytoshan's booming voice once again. Running over to the main control panel, Commander Weishan threw open the door. Pushing on all the circuit boards, the engineering chief felt one of the boards slip into place. Initialize the ILC again, yelled out the commander to his crew chief. Soon, the ion laser cannon was fully back online with a full canister of Halishan fuel. I hope the other ship has repaired their damage, thought Taishan as he heard his commanding officer tell the captain the ILC was ready to fire. Fire the ILC at that ship now, yelled the captain to his helmsman. Watching the main display from his chair on the bridge, Captain Pikeson yelled for his crew to brace for impact. He watched intently as blue and white light once again came out of the alien vessel. Soon, the brilliant and powerful laser struck Starship 1's shields. Amazingly, the powerful blast was deflected by the force field and ricocheted off into space. Captain, our shields are now at full power, the helmsman called out. Great job, engineering, shouted the captain over the bridge intercom. Thank you, sir, but we were actually not able to get all the crystals replaced that are required for full shield power. I am not sure how we are now at 100%, replied Commander Sujan. Captain, five Andoshian ships have just dropped out of FTL and now surrounding the alien vessel, called out Lieutenant Lishan. Hopefully these aliens have had enough and leave before they get destroyed, thought Captain Pikeson as he watched the main display. After watching the extremely powerful laser bounce off the enemy ship's force field, the Drago Crichton captain told his helmsman to prepare to fire the ILC again. Sir, scans have just picked up five other vessels. Deep scans show that while the ships are different than the other one, they do appear to be real. As he analyzed the current situation, Captain Krytoshan thought to himself, the shielding on that vessel is incredible. Based on their shielding technology, I wonder what kind of weapons technology they possess. We also have five more ships to contend with. I am not sure why they have not fired upon us yet, but it is time to leave. Commander Loras Shan, pack up and return to the ship immediately, called out Captain Krito Shan to his first officer, still on the surface of the Terran world. We have not completed the extraction, sir, replied the commander. I do not care. Leave the planet now, or you will be stuck there, yelled the captain to his first officer. Within minutes, Commander Loras Shan and his team were back aboard the Drago Crichton. Set a course for homeworld. Engage FTL now, commanded Captain Krito Shan. Extremely angry, the captain yelled out as he started to leave the bridge. I will be in my quarters. No one is to disturb me. Captain Pikeson watched as a smaller transport craft docked with the alien vessel. Soon the alien vessel went into FTL and disappeared. Upon seeing this, the entire bridge crew cheered. Great job, everyone. I need to confer with both the Andoshians and the Terrans, and then we will head back home, called up the captain as he rose from his chair. After discussions with the Andoshians and the Terrans, and all parties had left Starship 1, Captain Pikeson told his helmsman to plot a route back to Eurotopia and engage FTL. Relaxing in her cabin, Rochella heard the AI communicate that someone was at the door. Opening the door, Rochella saw the captain standing outside in the passageway. May I come in, Madam Counselor? Of course, Captain. Please come in. So, I am not exactly sure what completely happened today, but perhaps you could help explain some of the details over dinner tonight. How does 1900 in the cafeteria sound? That sounds good, Captain. I will see you in about an hour. With that, Captain Pikeson nodded and smiled at Rochella before turning around and leaving the cabin. This is going to be an interesting discussion, thought Rochella as she began to freshen up for dinner.